1890, Dr. Luc Montagnier, who discovered the virus originally, 6 months before Gallo's claim, made a startling statement. HIV might be harmless. Against his own interest, Montagnier's statement should have been earth-shaking, but the conventioneers paid it little attention and went right on talking about new antiviral drug treatments. Why is the scientific community ignoring the dangerous ramifications of this essential question about the cause of AIDS? Do we have an answer?
Yes, in retrospect, we certainly do. Too many people are making too much money out of it. And money is much stronger than truth.
When I was looking at this baby with our team the other night, it was reminiscent of 34 years ago in 1986 when we were struggling for drugs for HIV, and we had nothing. And there was a lot of anecdotal reports about things that maybe there were, maybe not. People were taking different kinds of drugs. And we did the first randomized placebo-controlled trial with AZT, which turned out to give an effect that was modest.
In 1987, the war on AIDS took another drastic turn for the worse. AZT, a toxic chemotherapy deemed too poisonous for cancer treatment, was approved to treat symptomatic and asymptomatic HIV patients in an attempt to kill the virus that causes AIDS. AZT is a DNA chain terminator, a poison designed to randomly destroy the DNA synthesis of reproducing cells. It was initially developed to treat leukemia victims, but after animal testing, the FDA determined that it was too toxic for use in human beings and banned it. But in 1987, when the AIDS scare hit its height, the FDA was pressured into approving the drug for use for the first time in human beings, even for people who were healthy and showed no sign of AIDS. AZT is highly mutagenic, meaning that it destroys the genes in cells and has been shown to cause cancer in rodents. It targets the bone marrow where B lymphocyte blood cells are being made. These are the very cells an AIDS patient needs most for immunity. AZT destroys randomly bone marrow, kidneys, liver, intestines, muscle tissue, the brain, and central nervous system. Peter Duisberg claims AZT actually causes AIDS itself.
AZT does directly causing AIDS defining diseases. You know, AIDS is a lot of things, but it doesn't cause Kaposi sarcoma or anything, but it does cause immune deficiency. It was designed to do that. It was designed to kill human cells. In fact, the manufacturer says that specifically that it can cause AIDS-like diseases. The manufacturer, that is, Bruce Wellcom, says it is often difficult to distinguish adverse events possibly associated with sirolimus or sirolimus administration, which is AZT, from underlying signs of HIV disease. In other words, even they acknowledge, not just this, but that AZT causes AIDS or AIDS-defining diseases.
Whenever you have clear-cut evidence that a drug works, you have an ethical obligation to immediately let the people who are in the placebo group know so that they can have access. And all of the other trials that have taken place now have a new standard of care. So we would have normally waited several days until the data gets further, dot the I and cross the T. But the data are not going to change. Some of the numbers may change a little, but the conclusion will not change.
In his book, Poison by Prescription, journalist John Lawrenson explains how AZT tests conducted by the FDA and Burroughs Wellcome, the manufacturer, were scientifically sloppy and outright fraudulent. During the experiments, patients taking AZT became anemic, suffered low white blood cell counts accompanied by vomiting. Over half had to have blood transfusions. 20% were transfused several times. Despite a warning by FDA toxicology analyst Hardy Chernoff that AZT not be approved, the FDA was pressured by AIDS activist organizations to lift the ban, and hundreds of thousands of people began taking AZT, even though AZT cannot cure AIDS and is only supposed to slow down the progression. The mortality